Good afternoon. Welcome to the Heritage Foundation in our Lewis Lehrman Auditorium. Of course, we welcome those who join us on all of these occasions on our heritage.org website. One bit of housekeeping, we would ask everyone here in-house to make that last courtesy check. Thank you, Lindsay, that cell phones have been turned off. It's always appreciated as we prepare to begin. We, of course, will feature this on our website following for your future reference. And for those watching online, they are welcome to send questions or comments at any time, simply emailing us at speaker@heritage.org. Hosting our guest today is Lindsay Burke, who is our Will Skillman Fellow in Education Policy. She researches and writes on federal and state education issues. She focuses on two critical areas of education policy, reducing the federal role in education and empowering families with school choice. Her commentary, research, and op-eds have appeared in various newspapers and magazines, including The Washington Times, National Review Online, The Atlantic, Time, and Newsweek. I note in relationship to our guest, it's not in the Wall Street Journal yet. She has spoken on education, reform issues around the country and internationally, and appeared on major television network programs as well. She is a graduate of Hollins College and received her master's degree in foreign language from the University of Virginia. Please join me in welcoming Lindsay Burke. Lindsay?
Great. Thank you, John, and thank you all for joining us today. I know we're going to hear a very interesting lecture from Jason Riley and really get an inside look at his new book. If you haven't had a chance to pick it up yet, we have it outside for sale in the foyer. Please Stop Helping Us, How Liberals Make It Harder for Blacks to Succeed. Mr. Riley begins by taking us back to 1965, when, in his commencement address at Howard University, President Lyndon Johnson stated that the next and more profound stage of the battle for civil rights was not just freedom, but opportunity, and not just equality as a right and a theory, but equality as a fact and equality as a result. And it is that last piece, equality as a result, that Mr. Riley contemplates and examines, and Please Stop Helping Us. What followed Johnson's speech at Howard was the enactment of various Great Society programs as part of the president's war on poverty. Mr. Riley examines, as he puts it, the track record of the political left's serial altruism over the past half century. Today's lecture comes, in fact, as we near that 50th anniversary of the Civil Rights Act and near the anniversary of a host of other Great Society programs, including the Higher Education Act, the Elementary and Secondary Education Act, Head Start, and various other welfare programs. In his book, Mr. Riley asks a number of questions about the premise and outcomes of those programs, which are nearly 50 years old. What if, he asks, there are limits to what government can do beyond removing barriers to freedom? What if public policymakers risk creating barriers to progress when the goal is the ever elusive equality as a result? At what point does the helping start hurting? Jason Riley is a member of the Wall Street Journal editorial board. He joined the paper in 1994 as a copy reader on the national news desk in New York. He moved to the editorial page in 1995 and later became a copy editor. In 1996, he was named to the newly created position of editorial interactive editor and maintained the editorial and leisure and arts section of WallStreetJournal.com. He was named a senior editorial page writer in 2000 and a member of the editorial board in 2005. Mr. Riley appears regularly on the Journal editorial report on Fox News and is a Fox News contributor. He has also worked for USA Today and the Buffalo News. Born in Buffalo, New York, Mr. Riley earned a bachelor's degree in English from the State University of New York in Buffalo. Please join me in welcoming Jason Riley.
Thank you for that introduction, John and Lindsay. Lindsay has actually appeared in the Wall Street Journal, just not under her byline, but she's been a fabulous source of mine over the years and someone I could turn to sometimes on very short notice to walk me through various policy initiatives that the White House released on a Friday afternoon on right before a long weekend at 5:30 p.m. when no one was paying attention. Lindsay was paying attention, so I want to thank her. And from where I sat as a journalist, that's pretty much what you get from the Heritage Foundation in general. So I want to thank them for hosting this event and for their support with the book and for doing what they do. I very much appreciate it. Tom Sowell, one of the people I dedicated this book to, once wrote that some books you write for pleasure, and other books you write out of a sense of duty, because there are things that need to be said and other people who have better sense than to say them. When I started out as a journalist 20 years ago, I really had no expectation of focusing on race per se. People like Sowell and Shelby Steele and Walter Williams and Clarence Thomas and other blacks, to my mind, had already said what needed to be said and had been saying it for decades and had been saying it more eloquently than I ever could. But over the years, and with some prodding from some of those guys, it occurred to me that not enough other black writers were following in their footsteps. It also occurred to me that liberal solutions to the black problems were just as wrongheaded today as they had ever been. Not only were they not working in many cases, they were making matters worse, much worse. And I wanted to push back at this sort of fake altruism, however well-intentioned. And the result is this book, which I hope will add another voice to that debate. As Lindsay mentioned, I grew up in Buffalo. And on a visit home many years ago, shortly after I started working at the paper, I found myself at my older sister's home chatting with my niece, who at the time was maybe in around second grade. And I was asking her about school and her favorite subjects and that sort of thing. And suddenly, out of the blue, she stops me and she says, "Why you talk white, Uncle Jason?" She then turned to her little friend who was there with her and said, "Don't my uncle sound white? Why are you trying to sound so smart?" Now, girls were just teasing, of course, and I smiled, and they enjoyed a little chuckle at my expense. But what she said stayed with me. I couldn't help thinking that here were two young black girls, 8 or 9 years old, already linking speech patterns to race and intelligence. They already had a rather sophisticated awareness that as blacks, white-sounding speech was not only to be avoided, but mocked in the speech of others. Now, I shouldn't have been too surprised by this, and I wasn't. My sister and countless other black friends and relatives teased me the same way when I was growing up. What I had forgotten is just how early these attitudes take place. 8-year-olds already afraid of speaking properly for fear of being called white or acting white. I spent a lot of time in the book talking about black culture, about the problems with black culture, and about how liberal politicians and policymakers and intellectuals do blacks no favors when they make excuses for black cultural defects instead of denouncing them. Now, blacks ultimately must help themselves. They must develop the habits, characteristics, behaviors that other groups had developed to rise in America. And to the extent that a social policy, however well-intentioned, interferes with that self-development, I argue that it does more harm than good, ultimately. More than 80% of black kids in New York City public schools are performing below grade level. And a big part of the problem is a black subculture that rejects the attitudes and behaviors conducive to academic success. Black kids read half as many books and watch twice as much television as their white counterparts, for example. In other words, part of the problem is a culture that produces little black girls and boys who are already worried about acting and sounding white by the time they're in second grade. Earlier this year, I was asked to talk about the legacy of Brown v. Board of Education, which 60 years ago declared racial segregation in public schools to be unconstitutional. Now, some of you might recall, those seem like a few young people out there, so maybe not all of you, might recall what happened to Bill Cosby 10 years ago on the 50th anniversary of that decision. The NAACP had invited Cosby to give a speech marking the occasion, and he used it to talk about black culture in the wake of Brown. He said that blacks today are squandering the gains of the civil rights movement, and that white racism is not to blame. He talked about single-parent families, fathers abandoning children, criminality, high incarceration rates, an aversion to school and learning, and so forth. We can't blame white people, he said. Brown v. Board is no longer white people's problem. He talked about all these black pioneers who broke down barriers, marched, got spit on, got punched in the face, even lost their lives. Yet when you look at the culture of the black underclass, he said, you see no appreciation of these sacrifices. And in conclusion, he said, what the hell good is Brown v. Board of Education if nobody wants it? Now, Cosby got a standing ovation from the crowd the evening he said those words. But in the weeks following the speech, he got slammed by black intellectuals who wanted to keep the focus on whites. They said Cosby was a wealthy man who was blaming poor blacks for their circumstances. They said he was ignoring systemic racism. They called him an elitist. But Cosby had the facts on his side when he argued that it was a cop-out to blame white racism for the breakdown of the black family and other subsequent cultural problems we see today in the ghetto. Cosby was raised in Philadelphia, where he was born in 1937. Now, in Philadelphia in 1880, 75% of black families were comprised of two parents and children, 75%, versus 73% of white families. By 2007, however, the number would be 68% for whites, but only 34% for blacks. Was there less racism in America 15 years after the end of the Civil War than there was a year before Obama was elected president? And Philadelphia was no outlier. Nationwide, data from every census taken between 1890 and 1940 show that black marriage rate exceeding the white rate up until 1940. So in a time of open, rampant racism, the black family was in better shape than it is today. The black incarceration rate was lower than it is today. The black labor participation rate was higher than it is today. Speaking of Obama, since becoming president, he too, on occasion, has spoken about the breakdown of the black family and its larger consequences. Last year, he spoke at Morehouse, a black college in Atlanta. And he said, I was raised by a heroic single mother and wonderful grandparents who made incredible sacrifices for me. And I know there are moms and grandparents here today who did the same for all of you. But I still wish I had a father who was not only present but involved. And so my whole life, I've tried to be for Michelle and my girls what my father wasn't for my mother and me. I've tried to be a better father, a better husband, a better man. He told those black men in the audience, be a good role model. Set a good example for that young brother coming up. If you know someone who isn't on point, go back and bring that brother along. The brothers who have been left behind, who haven't had the same opportunities we've had, they need to hear from us. We've got to be in the barbershops with them. We've got to be in the church with them, spending time and energy and presence helping to pull them up, exposing new opportunities. We have to teach them what it means to be a man. Now, that might sound like common sense to you and me. In fact, most people in this room, myself included, probably wish that this is all Obama would talk about all the time. But when Obama or Bill Cosby say these things, they get slammed by the white left and the black left. You are not allowed to talk about black culture. Those are fighting words. Yet again, the facts were on the president's side. In 2011, for example, 33% of children in America lived with their mother, but not their father. Among blacks, it was 64%. For decades, studies have shown that the likelihood of teen pregnancy, drug abuse, dropping out of school, and many other bad social outcomes increases dramatically when fathers aren't around. One study found that black boys with a father or black boys without a father were 68% more likely to be incarcerated than those with a father around. They found that, quote, overall, the most critical factor affecting the prospect that a male youth will encounter the criminal justice system is the presence of his father in the home. All other factors, including family income, are much less important. It's been nearly half a century since President Lyndon Johnson's 1965 speech at Howard, the historically black college here in Washington. Johnson had signed the Civil Rights Act a year earlier, and he'd signed the Voting Rights Act 2 months later. And he used the speech to talk about what the government should do next on behalf of blacks. This was merely the end of the beginning, he said, quoting Churchill. That beginning is freedom, and the barriers to that freedom are tumbling down. Freedom is the right to share and share fully and equally in American society, to vote, to hold a job, to enter a public place, to go to school, said Johnson. But freedom is not enough. He said, you do not take a person who for years has been hobbled by chains and liberate him, bring him up to the starting line of a race, and then say, you are free to compete with all the others, and still justly believe that you have been completely fair. Johnson said that the next and the more profound stage of the battle for civil rights was not just freedom, but opportunity, and not just equality as a right in theory, but equality as a fact, and equality as a result. That's how we were going to measure whether there was equality in America, by results. But what if Johnson was mistaken? What if there are limits to what government can do beyond removing those barriers to freedom? What if the best that we can hope for from our elected officials and policymakers are policies that promote equal opportunity? And what if public policymakers risk creating more barriers to progress when the goal is equal outcomes? The civil rights struggles of the mid-20th century were liberalism at its best. The efforts culminated in the passage of the Civil Rights Act and later the Voting Rights Act, which outlawed racial discrimination in employment and education and ensured the ability of blacks to register and vote. All Americans can be proud of these accomplishments. But what about the social policy and thinking that arose from the ruins of Jim Crow? Good intentions aside, which efforts have facilitated black advancement and which efforts have impeded it? In 1988, nearly a quarter of a century after the Great Society initiatives were launched, Nathan Glaser published The Limits of Social Policy, a critical assessment of two decades worth of programs that were premised on the liberal belief that government action is the best way to improve the lot of blacks. Quote, against the view that to every problem there is a solution, I came to believe that we can only have partial and less than wholly satisfying answers to the social problems in question, said Glaser. Whereas the prevailing wisdom was that the social policies would make steady progress in nibbling away at the agenda of problems set by the forces of industrialization and urbanization, I came to believe that although social policy had ameliorated some of the problems we had inherited, it had also given rise to other problems, no less grave in their effect on human happiness. Glaser understood the limits of government benevolence, but unlike Glaser, many liberals today, still riding high on those good intentions, don't seem particularly interested in reconsidering what has been tried, even though 50 years into the war on poverty, the picture is not pretty. While gains have been made, significant racial disparities persist in some areas, and black retrogression has occurred in others. The black-white poverty gap has widened over the past decade, and the poverty rate among blacks is no longer even declining. Overall, blacks aside, I read somewhere recently that in 1966, the poverty rate was lower in America among all groups than it was in 2012. The black-white disparity incarceration rates today is larger than it was in 1960. And the black unemployment rate has, on average, been twice as high as the white rate for 5 decades. Now, confronted with these statistics, liberals continue to push for the same solutions that clearly have not worked before. Earlier this year, President Obama announced yet another federal initiative aimed at helping blacks. He called for more preschool education, even though studies, like the one on Head Start, released by his administration in 2012, have found, quote, no significant impacts in education from such programs. Obama said that he wants to increase reading proficiency and graduation rates for minority students, yet he opposes school voucher programs that are doing both. And he called for more of the same job training programs that liberal politicians have been pushing for decades, despite scant evidence of their effectiveness. In his History of American Liberalism, Fred Siegel writes that he writes of a liberal flight from evidence and empiricism on racial matters beginning in the 1960s. The political left, racked by guilt over Obama, over America's diabolical treatment of blacks, decided to hold blacks to different standards of behavior. Blacks were invited to enter into the larger society on their own terms. The schools, which had once helped set poor whites on a path to success, ceased incorporating poor blacks from the backward South into mainstream culture, writes Siegel. Discipline as a prerequisite for adult success was displaced by the authentic self-expression of the ill-educated. Blacks, liberals said, were not culturally deprived, they were differently abled, more spontaneous and expressive. Liberals tried to improve conditions for blacks without passing judgment on antisocial black culture. Quote, like devout Christians getting right with Jesus, liberals struggled to get right with racism, writes Siegel. They wanted to help blacks in the worst way, and that's just what they did. After George Zimmerman was acquitted in the shooting death of Trayvon Martin, President Obama explained the black response to the verdict this way. They, meaning blacks, understand that some of the violence that takes place in poor black neighborhoods around the country is born out of a very violent past in this country, and that the poverty and dysfunction that we see in those communities can be traced to a very difficult history. Obama was doing exactly what liberals have been conditioning blacks to do since the 1960s, which is to blame black pathology on the legacy of slavery and Jim Crow laws. And the president is conditioning the next generation of blacks to do the exact same thing. I think this is a dodge. Those legacies are not holding down blacks half as much as the legacy of efforts to help blacks. The left's sentimental support has turned underprivileged blacks into playthings for liberal intellectuals and politicians who care more about clearing their conscience or winning votes than advocating behaviors and attitudes that have allowed other groups in this country to get ahead. Meanwhile, the civil rights movement has become an industry that does little more than monetize white guilt. Martin Luther King and his contemporaries demanded black self-improvement despite the abundant and overt racism of his day. But King's successors, living in an era when public policy bends over backwards to accommodate blacks, nevertheless insist that blacks cannot be held responsible for their plight so long as someone somewhere in white America is still using the N-word. Liberalism has also succeeded tragically in convincing blacks to see themselves first and foremost as victims. Today, there is no greater impediment to black advancement than the self-pitying mindset that permeates black culture. White liberals think they are helping blacks by romanticizing bad behavior, and black liberals are all too happy to hustle guilty whites. The result is a black obsession with racial slights, real or imagined. Supreme Court Justice Clarence Thomas touched on this phenomenon when he told an audience recently that America seems more color conscious than when he was growing up in the segregated South. More color conscious today, that is. My sadness is that we are probably today more race and difference conscious than I was in the 1960s when I went to school, said Thomas. To my knowledge, I was the first black kid in Savannah, Georgia, to go to a white school. Rarely did the issue of race come up, Thomas said. Now, name a day when it doesn't come up. Differences in race, differences in sex, somebody doesn't look at you right, somebody says something, everybody's sensitive. If I had been as sensitive as that in the 1960s, I'd still be in Savannah. Every person in this room has endured a slight, said Thomas. Every person, somebody has said something that has hurt their feelings or did something to them, left them out, etc. Now, liberals immediately attacked Thomas's comments. Charles Blow, a black New York Times columnist, wrote that, quote, "The racial reality of blacks in the South in the 1960s was that race consciousness was virtually inescapable and often stifling." Never mind that Blow was born in 1970, while Thomas was born in 1948. Blow was determined to lecture Clarence Thomas on life in the Jim Crow South. It's unclear to me, continued Blow, whether Thomas is being forgetful or whether he was oblivious. Either way, being unable to acknowledge and articulate the basic fact that race was and remains a concern for others is disturbing. That was Blow's conclusion. Much more disturbing to me is that half a century after the civil rights battles were fought and won, liberalism remains much more interested in making excuses for blacks than in reevaluating efforts to help them. Ironically, this concept of self-development is something black leaders once understood all too well in this country, and at a time when blacks faced infinitely more obstacles than they face today. Everybody is asked the question, and they learn to ask it early of the abolitionist. What should we do with the Negro, said Frederick Douglass in 1865. I have had but one answer from the beginning: do nothing with us. If the apples will not remain on the tree of their own strength, if they are worm-eaten at the core, if they are early ripe and disposed to fall, let them fall. And if the Negro cannot stand on his own legs, let him fall also. All I ask is give him a chance to stand on his own two legs. Douglass was essentially saying, give blacks equal opportunity and then leave us alone. Booker T. Washington, another black leader at the end of the 19th century, who was also born a slave, once said, it is important and right that all privileges of the law be ours, but it is vastly more important that we be prepared for the exercise of these privileges. Douglass and Washington didn't play down the need for the government to secure equal rights, and both were optimistic that blacks would ultimately get those equal rights, though they never lived to see it. But both men also understood the limits of government benevolence. Blacks would have to ready themselves to meet the far bigger challenge of being in a position to take advantage of opportunities once equal rights had been secured. The history of 1960s liberal social policies is largely a history of ignoring that wisdom. I'll stop there. Thank you.
Great. Well, Jason's kind enough to take your questions, so if you'll just raise your hand, we have mics coming around. If you wait for the mic to reach you. Yes, sir. You get the first one, Todd.
Todd Gonciano, recent, for many years, was here at Heritage and am now at the Pacific Legal Foundation, but I was also just finished a six-year term on the Civil Rights Commission, so I'm delighted with your book. I look forward to reading it. And I wanted to see if you would expand on one point that I think you touched. You talked about the role of the cult of victimology in explaining why, when things seem to be better, there's an increase in the divergence between whites and blacks. And clearly there is, you've a lot of people and you have established that government programs can't help in that, but people like Charles Murray 30 years ago, Amy Wax, more recently have said that it's the government programs themselves that undergird the cult of victimology. So it's not just that government programs can't help, but government programs are contributing in some significant ways to the sense that you can't achieve these you can't achieve without them, and even with them, the you know, you're unlikely to succeed. Do you have you explored that in your book, and what are your views on that in general?
Yes, I take up both issues in the book. To the first point, you have two things going on, I think, with regard to this black mindset, seeing yourself as a victim. You have a civil rights leadership that has a vested interest in keeping race front and center in the country. The left likes to complain that we're not in a post-racial environment, but that's the last thing in the world they would want. What would the NAACP do in a post-racial environment? Their whole agenda is keeping race front and center in our national conversations. That's what they want to talk about. And they have to continue to pretend that white behavior is responsible for black behavior. And so that's what they do. They have to pretend that nothing has changed since the 1960s, since the 1950s. That was the whole debate over the Voting Rights Act Supreme Court decision. All right? Obama's going to get up there and pretend that these states deserve the exact same scrutiny they had prior to the Voting Rights Act because their behavior is no different. Nothing's really changed. Even though, you know, the rate of black voter turnout in 2012 exceeded the white voter turnout rate, even in states with the strictest ID laws. But you have to pretend. You have to keep that illusion in place to justify your existence. And secondly, you have a media that continues to go to those black elites, those civil rights organizations, to speak on behalf of all blacks in America. So I think the media plays a role, too, in blacks seeing themselves as victims. In terms of government efforts doing more harm than good and not simply not helping but actually hurting, I think affirmative action is a perfect example of this, and I cite some of the work from the Civil Rights Commission on this. Take affirmative action in higher education. Policy, we've had 4 decades of this now. It's a policy intended to increase the ranks of the black middle class, create more black professionals. Yet when California ends race-based admissions in higher education back in 1996, black graduation rates in the system go up. They go up by more than 50%. Not only overall, they also go up by more than 50% in the more difficult disciplines of math and science. So as a result of affirmative action policies, we have fewer black professionals today than we otherwise would have had. And of course, what's behind that is that the policies were mismatching kids with schools. A great example of this is a study done some years ago at MIT. Black kids at MIT score in the top 10% on the math section of the SAT scores of all kids in the country. But they're in the bottom 10% of math scores at MIT. So you have these very smart kids who do be doing brilliantly in a less selective institution, but they're struggling at MIT. And MIT could really care less because
they're there to make the campus look like America. They're there to make the catalog look good. MIT cares what that freshman class looks like. Who graduates is a secondary concern at best when it comes to these black kids. And I think there's an example of a government program intended to help, not only not helping, but being counterproductive.
Yes, sir, right in front.
Hello, thank you very much for your talk. I enjoyed it a lot. I was wondering if you could comment on the theme of different subgroups in the black population and the comparative rates of success and what that says about the subcultural values. For example, the black West Indian population does exceedingly better than the average black American. This is a theme brought out by Thomas Sowell, and just what that says about the kind of overall argument that you're making.
Right. What it says is that it undercuts this argument that the left has made about racism being an all-purpose excuse for these outcomes. You're right, in many of more selective schools, the blacks that they do have there doing well tend to be black immigrants. And it speaks to the fact that it is a culture that a child brings with him to these various challenges. And a black West Indian is very different from a black kid in Harlem or a black kid in inner city Chicago and so forth. But that's really what it shows. But so much undermines the arguments made here with regard to culture. What really screws up a lot of the left's arguments are Asians. If you argue that the teaching methods in our schools today are too Eurocentric for black kids, what explains how well Asians do? I mean, if you argue that black kids are being kicked out of or suspended from school for bullying due to racism, what explains the fact that white kids are suspended more than the Asian kids? And even with affirmative action, I think what we're seeing now is some pushback from the Asian community, particularly in California, which wants to reverse the ban on race-based college admissions and is getting pushback from Asian lawmakers who say, oh, no, no, no. There are a fixed number of freshman slots here. And we found out after this ban went in place and we watched Asian enrollment spike that these affirmative action policies had been artificially depressing the number of kids on these campuses, that there had been, in fact, an artificial cap on Asians at these schools. They didn't want Asians overrepresented. And now that that race can't be taken into account, Asians are filling up, their numbers are going up, and they are opposed to going back to the old way of doing things. So I think that on the affirmative action front, that might be the big battle to watch going forward. Now, the black liberals will have to explain why Asians should be subject to these policies in response to the way whites treated blacks. Gets complicated.
All right, go back here. Yes, sir.
Laquan Austin with the Charles Cook Institute and Charles Cook Foundation. I know you did a phenomenal job outlining how a lot of government policies have hurt the groups they're intended to help. Is there a role at all for government in terms of education, or is it left to groups like the NAACP to kind of remedy some of those problems?
Well, like I said, I think what the government got right was the 1964 Civil Rights Act and the 1965 Voting Rights Act. And because those are, that levels the playing field. That creates equal opportunity. The problem is the government going beyond that and pushing for equal outcomes. And the reason pushing for equal outcomes is a problem is because nowhere in human history do we see equal outcomes. So if you're going to use that as your measure of success, until we see a proportionate number of doctors and lawyers and scientists and things must be unequal somehow. That's a fool's errand. There is nowhere where you're going to see that. Not only will you see it nowhere in U.S. history, you will see it nowhere in the history of other countries. Equal outcomes don't exist. So the only thing the government can really do is focus on equal opportunity. And then it is up to the various groups to make their own way. It's when the government goes beyond that and starts tinkering with the social engineering. Oh, we'll let black kids into the school with lower test scores. Never mind that, you know, black kids are reading 3 grades behind white kids when they graduate from high school. We'll cover it freshman year in college. No, that doesn't work. And you end up creating more dropouts, fewer black college graduates overall. That's when the tinkering, when the social engineering tinkering begins, I think that's when government goes astray. And so, again, to the title of the book, Stop. I'm more interested in what the government should stop doing that it's currently doing than I am in finding some other way for the government to help.
Yeah, let's go over here. Yes, ma'am, in the front.
Hi, thank you so much for coming today. I'm really looking forward to reading your book. I'm a student still, so this comes from a slightly different perspective. But in a time when not only is this, like you mentioned, not really a subject that people want to hear about because it does kind of ruin the left agenda, but also in a time when the left has been really good about kind of dictating who can talk about different issues, both in women's rights and when talking about the black community. So in a time when you have all of those factors, what's the best way, besides distributing your book, to reach people and to get this message to both the black community, but really to America as a whole?
I wish I knew the best way to get this out. I don't know that the problem, I don't know that the message isn't getting out to, like I said, I think a lot of what I write about in the book, about what's wrong with black culture, is so commonsensical in its nature. We all know industry and thrift. We all know the importance of a family, a mother, father in the home, pushing kids, keeping kids out of trouble, being role models. It's all common sense. I guess the goal is to push back at people who claim there should be an exception there for black culture because of the history of blacks, and then to push back at the solutions that they want to throw at the problem. If your goal is to reduce poverty, force them to explain how minimum wage increases are going to do that. If most of the people who make minimum wage aren't poor, and most poor people already make more than the minimum wage. Poor households in America are poor not because the people in those households have jobs that don't pay enough. They're poor because no one in the household has a job. And so to the extent that a minimum wage increase reduces job opportunities, it is not alleviating poverty. And I think you just need to take issues, because for the left, the face of the minimum wage debate is a single mom caring for 4 kids working at Burger King. But that is not your typical minimum wage earner. Your typical minimum wage earner is a white suburbanite working after school part-time, or a housewife earning some extra money while the kids are in school, or a senior citizen staying busy in retirement. Those are your typical minimum wage earners. But I think you just have to hold their feet to the fire. In New York, Walmart's been trying to build a store in a depressed neighborhood for years. Black elites don't want them to do it because the labor unions don't want them to do it because Walmart won't organize. Now, these are neighborhoods, they could use the jobs, they could use the store, they could use the goods and services. But the left would rather these people remain unemployed than work at Walmart. I mean, think about that. What right do they have to make that call? But that's And I think you just need to bring up these examples and bring some attention to them, because the stuff is really, it's really outrageous when you think about what they're getting away with and the arguments they're making to get away with them.
David Kreutzer at Heritage. You touched on it when you gave the example of MIT admissions. Mm-hmm. But do you find there's something like schoolism, that this notion that if you don't go to an elite school, you're destined to failure? I noticed your counterexample, and I like to think that I'm not an abject failure, even though I went to a state school. Mm-hmm. But I'm sure there are a lot of Ivy League English majors that would love to be on the editorial board at the Wall Street Journal. But my question is, Do you get a sense that the part of what's driving this is an elite notion that if you didn't go to the elite school I went to, how could you possibly succeed?
Maybe. I mean, I don't. I think what drives the left is this vision that they have of how America should look in terms of outcomes. And they're really just trying to tinker to make it look that way. You know, the justification for affirmative action has morphed over the years. First, it was compensating for past wrongdoings. Then, somewhere along the line, it became about diversity. And, of course, it's always one-way diversity. I can only bring diversity to you. Right? No one's complaining that Howard doesn't have enough white kids. So, but that's the new justification for it. And, whether they think they want these kids in these elite schools because they feel I don't think it's that primarily. I think it's just a view that America should look a certain way, our college campuses should look a certain way, our law offices should look a certain way, the professions in general should look a certain way. And they come up with all kinds of ways to justify this. You hear about the need for more black school teachers as a way of getting black kids more interested in school. White school teachers can't relate. Again, I bring up Asians. I mean, they are the ones exceeding everyone in education in this country. And they make up a tiny portion of the population. And most of their teachers are not Asian. So this notion that this is a solution. This is something we should be focused on. Increasing the number of black teachers as a way to help kids, black kids, do better in school. Where is the justification for this? Where is the data to back up this notion?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, getting back to the student's question about what can we do to bring these ideas more out to the general population, I kind of, one of my favorite peeves is this notion of that I hear people again and again pronounce that despite good intentions, and I hear this term again and again. You even use it a couple of times, and I want to question that, because there seems to be two levels of what liberals get out of this whole racial thing in this country. And the first is psychological, which whites have a lot, and they just seem to on a certain level they seem to love criticizing the fact that other people are racist and they're not. And they seem to get some kind of weird satisfaction out of that. And I've been in groups of liberals in which they throw out these comments again and again. And when they do this, they just have this certain selfish, I think, psychological feeling, satisfaction that they get. And then you brought out the money thing, that this racial stuff can be monetized in a big way. And I think on those two levels, that I think it's very reasonable to bring the battle to them and just say, you're being selfish, and that you don't have good intentions. And I really, in my own vocabulary, I've dropped that, and I don't give these people the benefit of the doubt that they have good intentions. And I think if we do that more often, I think that will somehow make some of these people question their own motivations. And if we bring the argument to them, because quite frankly, in a room when there are liberals and conservatives, the only non-racialists in that room are the conservatives. They don't have they're post-racialists. Hmm. In my observation, and I watch things very closely about this type of thing, and that's just my feeling. about when we bring this, when we try to change this country back to something better than what it is in terms of racial relations.
There you go.
Yes, ma'am.
A comment and a question. When you referred to Frederick Douglass's statement, you neglected to mention James Brown, who remember sang and wrote the song, "I don't want nobody to give me nothing, open up at the door, I'll get it myself." But also,
I'll have to add that.
First of all, do you think it is fair to compare Asians and West Indians with African Americans who have had an entirely different history? And secondly, what are your thoughts on The Promised Land, the book?
The Promised Land.
Yeah, it was a book written by, I think it's Thomas Lamont, and it describes African Americans living in Mississippi in the 30s and the 40s being visited by their relatives from Chicago. And it talks about the migration of those African Americans to Chicago and what was happening in Mississippi, in Chicago, as well as with the federal government during that period in terms of the accommodations. And I just didn't know if you...
I'm not familiar with the book, so I can't comment on that. To your first point about the comparisons with West Indians, for the purpose of pushing back at the argument that racism is driving these black outcomes, yes, you can make that comparison. What if you're a racist, are you cutting slack for West Indians, but not for me? I mean, we're both black. If racism is driving the unemployment rate, if whites won't hire blacks, what explains higher employment levels among West Indians? If racism is the result of outcomes in schools, academic outcomes, if there's no visual difference between a West Indian and a black American, yes, I think that's an appropriate comparison. Absolutely.
Yes, sir, in the front.
Hi. I thought your points on Asians were very interesting, but I was wondering, have you ever drawn comparisons between Jewish people and black people? Jewish people have obviously had a very rough history, but have been very successful in America. And, I mean, anti-Semitism obviously still exists.
I don't think it's productive to get into who's had it worse.
No, not at all. Right.
But the fact of the matter is many groups have had a tough go of it. And my point is that what have they used to rise from poverty to prosperity in the U.S.? And if you look at the history of certain groups, whether it's Jews, Asians, Irish, Italians, Germans, you see similarities in patterns. One of the things I didn't get into in the speech, but that I do in the book, is this debate over whether political power for a group is important in their rise from poverty. And I argue that history suggests it is not. And if you look at some of these other groups, Jews are a good example, Germans, Italians, Chinese, other Asian groups, their focus has been on economics first. The politics came later. The civil rights movement took the opposite route. It made the goal political power, culminating, of course, first in the passage of the Voting Rights Act and the Civil Rights Act, but also in pushing things like racial gerrymandering and to get more black elected officials. This was supposed to be a key to the rise of the black middle class. And then ultimately, you get a president, the culmination of this vision that political power is important. And my conclusion is that I think what it shows
in the age of Obama, after we've achieved this pinnacle in terms of the highest office in the land, that a black man in the home is much more important than a black man in the White House. I mean, that's the bottom line. And if you look at these other groups, that was the bottom line for them, too. And there have been some exceptions to this rule. Irish come to mind. Someone mentioned Tom Sowell earlier. He's done some work on this. So has Michael Barone. The Irish went the route that blacks have gone. They pursued political power first. In late 1800s, early 1900s, they had these political machines in cities, Philadelphia, New York, Boston. They were running things politically. But the Irish masses were not doing well at all. They remained in a very bad way for a very long time. And it wasn't actually until the fall, the decline of those political machines of the Irish, that the Irish began to rise as a group economically. So you can go another route. I mean, the Irish are doing fine today. But it was a much slower rise than the other groups experienced doing it in reverse, focusing on economics first. Focusing on what Booker T. Washington and Frederick Douglass were talking about, being prepared to take advantage of opportunities once the politics got right on that front.
Time for one more. Yes, sir, in the back.
Thank you, Dino Drudy, an interested citizen. What I find surprising is that there is relatively little debate among African Americans about this strategy. It just seemed to happen. Why do you think that is? Why is there not, and has there not been, for many decades, more grassroots pushback against this strategy which you describe as being so unsuccessful?
Well, I think I take issue with the premise. There was a huge debate about this between W.E.B. Du Bois and Booker T. Washington, a very big knockdown, drag-out debate. And Du Bois won. He won hands down, to the point where Booker T. Washington remains among some blacks, persona non grata. Obama gave an interview with The New Yorker earlier this year, and he was taking some flack for some of the things he had said about black culture. And he said to the interviewer something like, I say some of these things, and some people accuse me of having this sort of Booker T. Washington up by your bootstraps mentality. That's not what I'm talking about. I mean, it's the president saying, don't associate me with that mentality. There was a huge debate going on. I think the more interesting question today is, why, despite the failed efforts of the left, do you still get 90% plus black voting for the Democratic Party and for liberals? I think that's the more interesting question. And I think there are a couple answers to it. One is the history of conservatives in the civil rights movement. I mean, National Review magazine supported segregation in the 50s. And you have blacks alive today who remember that, haven't forgot that, won't forget that. I also think that the left has done a wonderful job of convincing blacks that government, bigger government, is better for them. And so you have a lot of blacks overly reliant on big government, whether it's in terms of jobs or in terms of handouts. You just have a disproportionate number of blacks wedded to big government. And that's going to be tough to reverse. I think they are in a very deep hole there. And thirdly, I'd say you don't have a huge outreach effort on the part of Republicans to seek black voters. They've pretty much conceded the black vote to the left. And I don't think there's racial animus behind that. I think the reality is that the Republican Party can still win elections without the black vote. And until that is no longer the case, I don't anticipate seeing a huge outreach effort. You have some exceptions. You know, Paul Ryan's been doing it. Chris Christie did it in his reelection bid in New Jersey. Over the years, you've had people like Jack Kemp or Richard Reardon out in L.A. or Stephen Goldsmith in Indianapolis. But those are really exceptions. there just isn't really a concerted effort. Right now in the GOP, you have a debate over Hispanic voters. People are saying, oh, can we still win elections if we don't tap into this voting block? And there's a debate over how to best go about doing that. But no such debate is really happening about blacks in the GOP. That just hasn't happened. And I think it's because right now they don't feel they need these voters. So I think that also blacks don't really feel they have much of an alternative in terms of who to turn to. But the debate goes back quite a ways. It goes back more than a century.
Thank you. Please join me in thanking Jason.